All through the sessions today, there have been several references to pollution, contamination, water quality, and I think a lot of discussion. I'll be talking about different possibilities for interventions, as is interesting to talk about here. This will be the structure of the presentation. First, I'll be talking about different ranges of groundwater quality interventions, which will go into several sectors. Not just water supply sanitation, but also watershed, agriculture, public health. Various sectors, there is a scope for different sectors to actually get involved in working on groundwater quality. The data and research needs, which are needed for these interventions. I'll go into an example which I'm familiar with, because our organization is involved in that particular example. And then what we learn about all of this. The limitations of PowerPoint effort, this will be one way to just go through the concept, the mind map, something which I'm trying for the first time. Let's see how it goes. So the way I see water quality interventions is, it comes as a sequence here. The first step, we have all been talking about it since morning, is I think prevention of contamination. If you can prevent contamination right at the outset, then you don't need to think about anything else. You don't need to think about disease or anything. If you're not able to do this, I think the next step is here. It's prevention of disease. We're talking about nitrate or fluorides. If you're not able to prevent contamination of groundwater, you'll end up with this. If you're not able to do this, and if you're not able to prevent disease, then I think we need to work on mitigation of disease. Who needs to work about mitigation of disease? Someone needs to work on mitigation of disease. And finally, I think if you're not able to do this, that is mitigation of disease, then finally let's at least talk about rehabilitation. And the unfortunate part is that there are a lot of people who are here today at this point. There are a lot of victims of public health issues, water quality related issues. Across all these stages, they cannot be, the disease cannot be reversed. It's at the stage they are at this particular stage. So when we talk about water quality problems, we also have to be talking about all these different aspects together. So I'll quickly go through each of these. So if you talk about prevention of contamination, then I think a lot of different things, that a lot of different interventions, a lot of different ideas come into the picture. We talked today in the urban context, but also in the rural context, about safe sanitation, which is very important because of the stopping spread of diseases. Protecting safe drinking water sources from irrigation use, major problem because of the fact that especially in rains in the summer seasons, aquifer just dries up. Whatever water you just put in, recharge anything, it just gets out for many areas. Then organic farming or low pesticide farming, low fertilizer use farming, reduce chemicals. Fire remediation, I think it's being talked much more in the private sector. There are several companies who clean up the aquifer before they occupy a site so as to avoid future litigation. And I know there are companies who are spending a lot of money to do it. But most of these are multinationals because they are required by the source. Country laws to do this groundwater. I have not seen that much happening in the civil society in the sector. And then aquifer recharge, whether that leads to dilution, whether it can be managed and lead to better quality. Industrial effluent, solid waste management. So I think these all come into the picture of prevention of contamination. And my guess is that we will be talking mostly about prevention of contamination here. And little bit about here. So if you cannot prevent contamination of the aquifer, then I think we go into safe drinking water supply, out of the aquifer itself, or using the aquifer water, water treatment at a community level or at a domestic level. We're talking about external water supply, even if this doesn't work, rainwater harvesting, tapping unpolluted sources, even within pockets in the aquifer, maybe there are sources which are safe. But I think till here, I think there have been a lot of discussions in the room, but not the remaining two, which is also very important. Because there is a lot of transport of contaminants through different media. There is bioaccumulation in food, in different biological media, and then transmitting through humans to the food chain. And I think a lot of prevention of disease can also be done. That is last point here. This is basically just early diagnosis and detection of disease. If you are able to detect dental fluorosis in children, then you act right then so that 20 years from now, the child will not be affected with dental fluorosis. So these sort of things could be done, and I don't think we are thinking about those such interventions. Then coming on to mitigation of disease. There's been a lot of work now over many years by doctors working on specific problems. This is for detoxification of chemicals from the body, specific contaminants in the body. There have been different nutrition-based therapies which people have been trying out with very level of success. And if there are medications, if there are surgical or prosthetic solutions available for certain types of problems. Lastly, I would like to come to the point of rehabilitation of victims who are affected by water quality problems. And the first thing, I think the first option within that would be just to look at livelihood options for just like, you know, before the mobile cell phone age, there were these phone booths in cities. And many of these phone booths were actually manned by people who had disabilities, different sort of disabilities. Things of that sort, the rehabilitation of victims who are affected by and then adaptation mechanisms for this. And I think the last recourse after all of these is compensation. So if you want to look at water quality interventions, I feel that maybe this is not comprehensive, but it's there are a lot more points to think about. But I feel that you need to think about all these together. There are a lot of opportunities for intersectoral participation, for NGOs, for governments, for different government departments. And I think just one organization cannot work on all this, but there needs to be a coordination to work on all these together. And there is different data and research needs for all of this. So if you take just water quality, there are a host of water quality related data requirements. There are a host of food chain system data requirements, a host of nutrition related data and disease data. So this, when you go into water quality itself, you need to know, as Himanshu pointed out, just water quality data is not enough. But you need to have a conceptual geological understanding which is backing this water quality data that helps to understand the problem itself. So I won't go into detail into all of these because I think it will be too much of description. But point that I'm trying to put forward here is that when we talk about water quality interventions, let's not just talk about water supply. When we talk about water quality interventions, let's talk about this entire picture together. Maybe there are different actors, different people who could be involved, but this is the entire picture which needs to be addressed. So with this background, coming from the way being an organization see water quality problems, I would like to go to one particular example, which is that of fluorosis, which we and an organization are working on, and it's in this border area of Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh, Jhabua district in Madhya Pradesh, which is a region which is also neighboring Dhar district, where Mr. Asif today pointed out about the work on fluoride, which is being supported by Water Aid. So there is this entire region of 5 to 6 districts which are affected by fluoride problem. If you take Baswade district in Rajasthan, Aligarhpur in Madhya Pradesh, Ratlam in Madhya Pradesh. So there is these 5 or 6 districts which also have common food and nutrition habits. You know, there's a similar culture. Tribal culture which cuts across the border areas of these three states, Gujarat, MP, and Rajasthan. And there's a common problem of fluorosis in these in this entire area. We are working there through a center called the Fluorosis Mitigation Center, which we have established, and trying to describe the stages that have come to be that I've described before. It is first prevention of contamination, prevention of disease, mitigation of disease, and rehabilitation. And let me accept right at the front, we are not working on all this. So when I come to the specific points, I'll try to point out the challenges on why we are not working on some of these points. First, I'll just come to prevention of contamination. Now, as Himanshu was earlier pointing out, the water quality data by itself will not tell us anything unless you have a basis for conceptually understanding what they really mean. So here there are two sets of data from the same place, same aquifers, where you see that the left side has very high values of fluoride, close to 7-10 milligram per day. There are also low values. But the right side is predominantly low wells. There are only four wells, which have high fluoride values. So these are all dug wells in the area, these are all hand pumps, shallow groundwater, there is deeper groundwater. And this is a common, this you cannot say, you cannot predict for every well, but this is a common picture which you find. In that particular region, for the geology that exists there. So what does it say? What does it inform us? One thing surely that it informs us is that if you just if you're just able to use double water for drinking, then you are almost safe. You don't have a fluoride problem. You're safe throughout the year. But then, can we assure double water throughout the year? Is it really possible? There have been interventions which have tried to do that. But when you look at the previous picture that I spoke about, prevention of disease, mitigation of disease, then when you go and talk to the person who has a disease and say that there is 60% chance, 70% chance that I can give you fluoride water, that's not a way in which you address a disease. You actually got to arrest the entry point of fluoride first and then start talking about different levels. So when you come to a situation in which a person is expected to have double water for drinking, and there's a chance that if the community participates, then you also have a supply of safe water, then the interest on that patient, or interest on the family, goes down a little bit. You need to also look at individual solutions, individual level adaptations, so that people get interested. This, I think, also philosophy, also thinking, which not everybody could agree with. But I feel that you need also to get at individual level adaptation issues also, apart from community or collective level actions. So for example, irrigation. If there is a moderation in irrigation use of groundwater, then yes, double waters are going to remain prevalent. But that requires a much greater effort, especially in the area where irrigation is very much important for livelihood. You cannot expect people to just stop pumping. I don't know about fertilizers. Are there certain fertilizers which are helpful in mobilizing fluoride in aquifer? So these are the open questions. And answering maybe these questions can help in prevention of contamination. But as I said, we are not working on prevention of contamination. I would like to put the work that we're doing mainly in the bracket of prevention of disease and mitigation of disease. So in prevention of disease, as I pointed out, the juvenile fluorosis, especially in these areas, is remarkably high. You find 5 to 6 year old children who have bored legs, 10 to 15 year old children who have extreme form of skeletal fluorosis, which you find in other areas at much greater age. And naturally the question arises as to why this should be the same fluoride levels. So we have been doing rapid surveillance on a larger level, rapid surveillance and diagnosis on a larger level for just dental fluorosis. But then in order to go deeper and understand the disease, we need to have different other diagnostic procedures that help you to understand the disease better. And for that, X-rays help you, but who is going to analyze these X-rays? If you go to the public health doctor, PHC, who is actually responsible for the patient, there's nobody who is going to analyze that X-ray for you in terms of understanding fluorosis. There are very few doctors in the country who can interpret an X-ray for understanding skeletal fluorosis. So we are in fact lucky that there have been several doctors across the country who are volunteering their support for working on fluorosis. There are maybe, I think, less than 10, 15 doctors who I can say that they have experience on understanding fluorosis, and they are waiting for people to, they are monitoring their report. I think others can also take advantage of these problems. So the diagnosis for these victims was that it's not just fluorosis, but there is also juvenile osteoporosis arising from malnutrition. There's a combination of calcium deficiency as well as fluoride deficiency in these patients. So as I said, the other entry point is through food, because food can be irrigated by the same fluoride water. But in this case, you have food which is irrigated mainly by the double water. There is electrification coming now, and there is usage of borewell water for irrigation. So maybe the entry of fluoride to food, as it is happening on a massive scale in AP and Karnataka and Rajasthan, it can also happen in places like this. But this is an early stage of fluorosis in these places. As you find here, maybe just poor land which is irrigated by double water has a significantly higher amount of fluoride. But if you look at the daily amounts of intake of other food cereals over here and compare with how much fluoride is there, it is not as high as what is entering through water, which is around 8 milligrams per liter. So if you look at the daily intake of around 20 milligrams, 25 milligrams per liter, maybe there is 3 or 4 milligrams which is coming in from food, and the remaining 20, 22 is coming from water. So naturally, we should focus on water. So in our intervention here in terms of prevention of disease, we are therefore focusing much more on water initially, to arrest the prevention of, to work on the prevention of disease. In our case, we're working on household level solutions in terms of housing or technology such as activated alumina, which has been used widely before and also now in other places. We are housing it within the local pot, which people are familiar with, and using it at a family level. and we use 0B as an initial filter for removing wide amounts of bacteria. So this addresses the prevention of disease point in terms of just entry of preventive point. But then, as I said, the diagnosis of the disease that you have in this area is not just because of fluoride, but it is also because of calcium deficiency. There has been research which has been done in several parts of the country, clinical trials, which have shown that some particular nutrients have the ability to actually detoxify contamination in the body, detoxify fluoride in the body, especially magnesium and vitamin C. So we also use a combination of calcium, magnesium and vitamin C. And as far as possible, we are trying to address nutrition enhancement through food supplements. But it's not possible, you know, there is not a place where people drink milk. There's almost zero milk consumption. So how do you bring calcium in into the diet? So we're using pharma supplements for calcium, magnesium, vitamin C. And we have been trying to use amla, that is vitamin C, gooseberry, for a daily intake of vitamin C, dried amla and salted sweet amla. But as I was talking with Vishwanath before, there's also an issue that there are some things which go at an individual level like tablets, and there are some things which go at a family level like food supplements. So very recently we also tried to, instead of going for a amla supplement such as dried amla which goes into food, we're trying to go in terms of amla powder or tablets, which you know people can just a patient can just take, which is there in the top. So these are different things that we've been trying, and when we started working in 2010, we had no idea about whether all this is really going to lead to a sort of detoxification in the body. But one main indicator, there are two main indicators which you can observe for looking at fluoride in the body. One is urine and other is blood sample. Urine, what it shows you is how much fluoride is ejected out from the body. Blood serum is in equilibrium with the body tissues, and it is able to tell you how much fluoride is deposited, it is there within the body, within the blood tissues, and within the body tissue. So blood serum levels, if you measure it today or tomorrow or day after, it's almost going to remain the same. Whereas urinary fluoride, today morning or today evening, it's going to be different depending on what kind of food I take, what is the pH of the urine, so on. So the indicator which you would like to observe for long-term observation of fluoride in the body is blood serum. But unfortunately, when we wanted to look at it, unfortunately, we went around the country and there's almost no laboratory in the country which does testing, except for Dr. A.K. Sushila's laboratory in Delhi. So we are fortunately able to take it by train from Ratlam and take it over there. But there's one of our partners who is in remote Assam. You know, even if they have money, they cannot just leave it. It's impossible, almost. Take it from remote Kabi or Long to our team. So these are, you know, practical constraints, infrastructural problems that we have, in which even if there's an organization at the field wanting to do all this, they cannot just get started. I'll just quickly go through results.
Are you saying that both urine and serum, you can't test it at laboratory, only serum that's there?
Especially for blood serum. Because the amount of the quantity of blood serum that you get, you need a micro electrode, which nobody keeps, and also the reagent you get for that. You cannot have 100 milliliters of blood. That's also. So what this plot shows is blood serum levels in fluoride. This black line here is kind of the safety limit. So 0.06 is kind of the limit which should exist in the body. So these children were around, you know, these blue levels last March. And we again observed this January, and they have reached to the level of red levels. That is, the blood serum levels have reduced from the blue ones to the red. This was quite a surprise even for us. We were not expecting that would be actual detoxification of fluoride from the blood serum. There are three children in our group who had to leave the village for higher studies. And unfortunately, the school that we ended up with also had fluoride. So that kind of became a control sample where there was an increase in blood serum levels. We are not doing a very controlled clinical research, but this is all that we can observe. So what it showed us was that surely there is kind of a reduction of fluoride from the blood serum. And this has been also shown by evidences in terms of perceptive evidences, the way children walk, and the children who have bold legs, who are now able to, like the manner in which you walk, you have a bold leg, is on the main of the side. But now you are able to bend your legs and go forward and run this. And then there are children who are able to take that boat to a larger distance to the forest, things of that sort. So people are also reporting such kind of feeling in terms of pain and various other things. And last point, the fourth point in terms of interventions, I will again go back. The last point which I said was about rehabilitation. We are not working on rehabilitation, but I think it's important because if you go to Kolar, parts of Kolar, if you go to parts of Nalgonda, it's very depressing. And there are people fighting for words on their name. And they don't have a they don't have a future. They're not going to, the disease is not going to reverse. There are people spending crores of money on their name, and their disease is not going to come back at all. These are victims who are stuck with the problem. They're stuck with fluorosis. So I think the only option for them is mild kind of reversal in terms of pain and stuff, but then you have to talk about rehabilitation of these victims. So if you're going to a place where you just talk about water supply, and someone asks you, so what is going to happen to me? I have this sort of a situation. So what is your reply? Can you say that, okay, no, I just focus on drinking water supply, I just focus on toilets? You cannot say that. You have to have an answer about what you're going to do, what people like. You have to have an answer. So for an organization like us, we didn't have an option in terms of, we started with filters, but then we have gone on to various other things and just discovered ourselves just because of these questions that we're getting from. So I think we need to think about all of these, but I don't have answers. Like, I don't know how much of this can be used. So what we learn? I think the first set of points is there is immense cross-sectoral activities which are important. We keep blaming the government that the government just focuses in one eye, but that's true for any sector. That's true for NGOs. That's true for different programs of funding agencies. It just focuses on a single eye in a single direction, without thinking of a larger problem many times. It's unfortunate. I think there's opportunity for all of this. From what I've described now, we can see opportunity for watershed, water supply, sanitation, agriculture, irrigation, public health, women, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of opportunities. But I accept that not one organization can work on all of this. There's someone needs to coordinate. Someone needs to look at the larger picture and say, okay, this part is being done by so-and-so, this part is being done by so-and-so. Then there are basic infrastructural problems, as I said, blood serum, if you want to measure blood serum fluoride, there's no place that you can do it. So lack of facilities for testing and lack of basic understanding for detection of disease. Doctors are not trained. There is a lot of research needs, and even in prevention of contamination, does recharge and dilution lead to low amounts of fluoride? How many experiments do we have? 2, 3, 4. We keep repeating the same phases. We don't have too many observations on this. Adaptation to disease and detoxification. I think there's a lot of detoxification which can happen. We also have herbal-based things and a lot of different opportunities. We have to look at all of them. But I think the point which I would like to come forward, which I've been before, it's just a perception, and I feel it's important. I think it's there in the sense that you have a movie which is made called Cleptolin, and it goes into the Oscar. So someone is taking leadership for a cause. Someone is taking leadership for an issue, and when someone takes leadership for an issue of that sort, then things get into the larger picture, big picture, and it comes together. So we need leadership for also issues instead of leadership for approaches. We will have a lot of leadership for approaches, but we also need leadership for individual issues. And I think when we have such leadership for issues, then I think the pieces will fit together.